everybody. Today on the channel, the continuing saga of one man's quest to build the perfect Aston Martin. And in this episode, we revisit a familiar car to see if it's now what it was always supposed to be, and if it could also be the ideal next Aston for me. This is actually the third time I have featured this very car on the channel. The first time it was as standard, a very nice 2016 Aston Martin V8 Vantage S, what many would already consider to be an excellent car, a beautiful blend of stunning good looks, performance, noise, and a great badge. However, for others, they can always see a little bit of room for improvement. And such was the case for this car's owner, Richard, from the YouTube channel Challenge the Road. You see, Richard is a man that has a little bit of money, but more than that, a lot of passion and time. And he's become rather fascinated with the Vantage. He has himself owned a number of them, including the GT8. But though many do consider that a great car too, for him, it was just a little too much for the road, and it's a very, very expensive thing. So he figured there would be a little bit of room for taking a regular Vantage, spicing it up a bit, and giving people the best of everything. He began with an early 4.3-litre car, which I drove and really loved. However, as the prices of the later 4.7s then dropped, he decided that modifying 4.3s just wasn't really going to be worth it, so started working on the 4.7. And he brought me this as an unmodified standard car, so I could get a good baseline, re-familiarise myself with it, and then, once he'd done some mods, I could give it another go. He subsequently got in touch with me a few months later and told me, right, I think it's just about ready for your first attempt. And because I am the good friend that I am, I convinced him that in order to give it a thorough evaluation, I had to take it all the way to Scotland and do a couple of thousand miles in it, which I did. And I didn't like it. But Richard, being the good guy that he is, rather than moan at me for that, instead took my feedback on board, and as it happened, already agreed with half of it anyway. And now the car is back, having had a number of other changes, and though it's certainly not a finished product, he does believe it is far closer to that than it was before. What's changed? Well, just in case you haven't seen the previous videos, overall, the car is quite a bit lighter than standard. So by default, it weighs closer to 1600 kilos, and now it's just over 1500. In terms of power, nothing radical has really gone on under the bonnet. The car has had a few little tweaks here and there, popular things to do to these engines, and it now makes a claimed 460 horsepower, up from the stock 430, a very believable figure. And in fact, nothing really in that department has changed between this time and the last. It's a mighty thing, this. Makes a great noise, courtesy of the racing back box that it's wearing. Very NASCAR, very vocal, very Brian Blessed. And it's also ruddy quick. This thing shifts. The last Vantage that I drove was the N400, the 4.3-litre Roadster, and that has a little less power, a little less torque, and carries a fair bit more weight. In the real world, over 200 kilos compared to this. And though this doesn't quite have the shove of, say, my DB9 with the nice 6-litre V12, it doesn't feel particularly far off either. It's a really very impressive setup. And when I drove the car before up in Scotland, I commented that it really didn't need any more power, and that is still true today. It was also while driving that car that I was reminded of one of the most subtle and yet significant modifications Richard makes to his cars, the fitment of a new accelerator pedal, which is absolutely necessary because for some bizarre reason, from the factory, Aston Martin set these cars up in such a way that heel and toe is virtually impossible. The brake and accelerator are simply too far apart, so with a new little cover that blends in very nicely with the pedals on the throttle, you can now actually achieve that. However, there were a few things that I did not like, and they included, in no particular order, the looks of the thing. Because Richard had fitted this big GT4 splitter at the front, and that didn't work for me for a number of reasons. First off, The car is already stunning, and to me, doing things like that was like putting googly eyes on the Mona Lisa. More than anything, because he'd put stuff at the front and not at the back, it then looked very unbalanced. His solution was to fit a wing to it, and although initially I was really concerned about that, I have to be honest, I'm going to eat my words on this one, because it now looks absolutely sensational. This all-carbon item that he's had fitted is not the same as the genuine Aston Martin AMR wing, which I've never been fond of. I don't actually know where he's got it from, but it looks awesome. I really, really like it, and it's visually balanced the car. It's also got a different set of wheels on it. Before, it had the 20s from ADBS. Now it has a set of 19-inch Apexes, and they look perfect. I really like the Apex wheels. They are flow-formed, not forged, so they're a little lighter than standard, but not as light as they could be. I think they look perfect. The car also suits having a little bit more rubber on it, and because the DBS wheels were designed for a DBS, they just didn't sit right on the whole car. They were all wrong, and I think they contributed to one of its other big problems. Now though, with those alloys on, even in silver rather than the bronze of before, I think they look really, really stunning. In terms of rubber, the car has a set of Michelin PS4S, which I also appreciate, because when conditions are as mixed as they have been this week, Richard did deliver the car fully valeted and immaculate, and it didn't stay that way for long, so thank you, Richard, for that, and apologies. I didn't get the time to get photos while it was clean. Instead, I just went out and enjoyed it. But it's worked. It's not been scary or anything of the sort to drive, even when it's been absolutely bucketing it down. Inside, he has also made a couple of changes. I complained about this gear lever in the last installment because it just felt a little bit cheap and nasty, and he has actually got in a brand new one for it, but unfortunately it just didn't arrive in time for this review. But it was a minor gripe, and one that I'm quite happy to ignore, because it is something you can easily change. Another thing that is different that you may not notice on first inspection is the seats, because where before it had a set of Cobra Negaros, now it has Recaro pole positions. In truth, the Cobra Negaros are essentially their version of the pole positions. But there was an issue with those Cobras. They're a seat that both Richard and I know fairly well. I had them in my Lotus Evora, and though they're not perfect, I got on with them fairly well. In this, though, they just seem to pinch my upper body a lot more than I ever remember them doing. He looked into this and found out that actually, at some point in time, Cobra had changed the dimensions of the seat, and it was genuinely narrower. So he decided, rather than try and fix that, which seemed unfixable, he'd just get the pole positions, because they are widely regarded to be the best in the business, and for a good reason. Beautifully comfy, very supportive, they are probably the best seats in the world. But the big change for this car is an all-new suspension setup. Out went the old one from a brand that is very well known but shall remain unnamed, because Richard was never, ever that happy with them, and neither was I. The car was just needlessly crashy all the time. And in has come a brand new setup from Intrax, which has been custom tailored to this particular application. It is not adaptive like the old system, it is passive, but it does have a function called ARC, anti-roll control. And it took me a little while to decipher exactly what was going on, but as best I can tell from the literature that Intrax provide, what they've done is prescribe a very specific curve for the damping of the car. And the idea is that you can then pair it with a slightly softer damper. And the way they've set it up, if you're simply in a corner and the weight is transitioning without too much force, it will remain fairly level and stable. But if you're encountering a high-speed transition, in other words, a bump, it will let the damper do its thing. The car has also been raised a little bit over before, partly because with the new wing, when on track, it created so much downforce, the rear arches were rubbing. In fact, they actually think the rear wing might have generated enough downforce, it cracked one of the rear lights. And I don't know about you, but all this speak of downforce had me concerned. Because initially, the brief for this car was that Richard wanted to build the best road-going Aston. And then I saw that he started taking his car on track. And then I saw that he'd hired a British touring car driver to do consultancy. And I figured, well, that's the idea of a nice road-going Vantage out the window. But Richard is aware of this, and he currently has no fewer than four Vantages that he's working on, including a V12. I'm quite looking forward to driving that. And this one is designed to be the more road-biased. It's also the first one he sort of got, really, and it's been used to essentially prototype and test everything. I also should point out that if you do want to go and buy one of these cars from him, and he will happily sell you one, it would be tailored to your requirements anyway. You can essentially have as much or as little of it as you want, and his prices are all really very reasonable, because he's not doing it to make a profit, he's just doing it because he loves the cars. And I'm quite happy to see someone playing around with something that's not a 911 for once. Excited though I certainly was to get this car back on the driveway, I have to say I was very, very concerned that now, with his focus on track days and the like, it was just ruined. But need I have worried? Well, let's get past these people collecting, I think, sugar beet or heaven knows what, and find out. Is the answer to that question. The first sort of 200-300 yards I did in the car were heartbreaking, because it's still quite firm at low speeds, and I just thought, oh, he's not learned a thing, has he? But that is not true at all, because though yes, the car is still a little bit bouncy around town, it's not quite as harsh and as crashy as it was before. The slightly smaller wheels with the slightly more generous profile tyres, I'm sure, are helping there. However, this suspension and all its trickery is not just a marketing gimmick. It really works. It reminds me very much of the Olin system that I have on my S2000. You can feel it working, you can feel it doing stuff, and it's still firm. But it feels like it's working at a very high refresh rate. It is doing its business very quickly indeed. And the thing for me is that the Vantage S was already a car that, in standard guise, was probably firmer than it needed to be for the road. The previous setup for the suspension then just made it even worse for no apparent benefit. This fixes that, because now you get it up to about 50 mile an hour or so, the whole thing begins to work. It just smooths out the road, it talks to you, the steering is better, the car turns in a little bit better, it's communicative. And now when you get it on a nice fast flowing bit of B road, which is really where this car should come alive, it does. I've spent a lot of time in Aston Martins recently, and for that reason I've made quite a bit of content on them. If you've been enjoying it and you haven't yet subscribed, please do, and tell me down below exactly what sort of stuff you really like watching. If you don't like it so much, why are you even here? But jokes aside, please do tell me what other cars you'd like to see featured. Oh, this is good. I cleaned it earlier, and this carbon V12 style bonnet has got quite a few places for the water to hide, and every now and again I go around a bend and it evidently catches a bit of air from somewhere, and it just sprays the screen with a little bit of water. But oh, this section of road I know intimately, and with the previous suspension this car was no fun. You were just getting bounced around all the time. Now, oh, it's so good. I just want to be in this thing all day long. It's a joy. Power is right, the gearbox is good, the clutch is still horrible, it is in all manual Aston Martins of this era. I stalled it three times in a car park the other day, particularly if you're trying to reverse, it's just needlessly difficult, but it's magic, absolute magic this. You've also got plenty of mid-range, so that if you want, you don't have to have it in the lowest gear possible, revving it all the way out to the red line, which frustratingly isn't marked on the dash. Grip levels are fantastic too. I have also on occasion dabbled with the traction control mode, which is a kind of halfway house, but honestly, I've not really found it to be all that intrusive. And as it's not my car, and I really would like to return it in the same condition I was given it, poor cleaning job aside, I'm not going to play around with it too much, but I did actually do one test the other day where I got myself on a nice straight and empty piece of road and gunned it in first, and the differential did its job, which is certainly more than I can say for the Audi R8 GT rear-wheel drive that I had recently. That was just, well, terrifying. I'm also now coming to this review from a very, very different perspective, because you see, the last time I drove this car, I still was not an Aston Martin owner. Now I am, or at least for the next week anyway, until I deliver the DB9 to its new owner up in Scotland. And I have really, really enjoyed Aston Martin ownership, and recently I've been thinking about which one I would get next, because the Aston Martin community have been really good to me and I've enjoyed making the content. I think there's still plenty more that I can do. And though I really, really lust after a DBS, because they're gorgeous, I think practically speaking, the Vantage is the car that makes a bit more sense for me. And something like this, oh, it's nice. My primary concerns, I think, for this particular car would be ground clearance. There's a few car parks I'd like to go to that I know that splitter would not enjoy. In fact, I'm not really sure whether the car needs that and the wing or not. Although, I have noticed now with the wing on, this car has a dramatically improved small boy appreciation factor. Driving past the school as they're chucking out, and the kids love it. People pay a lot more attention to this car than I thought they might, and that wing I know has a lot to do with it, because last time, not really many people looked. Now they do. I'm also not entirely sure how I feel about the exhaust, because though it does sound quite good, I prefer a slightly higher pitched, more complex noise, like you get, for example, from a Maserati V8. There are, of course, a number of different solutions to this, and this back box also is unvalved, so it's always this noise. The car also on long journeys does suffer from road noise quite a bit, but this is just a general Vantage issue, not specific to this car. I think it's better though than it was, and one of the reasons it doesn't have a set of fully forged wheels on it, Richard has some, is because that is one of the compromises that you make. The turn-in is better, but the road noise apparently is worse. I also am beginning to think increasingly that I would want a car with this latest infotainment system. The ability to just plug your Android Auto or Apple CarPlay into it is nice. The frustration is that in the Vantage, they're a fairly rare thing. They only appeared from about 2016 onwards, so there aren't many cars with it, and a lot of the ones that I see don't really then have a great spec. I also really need to try a few other Vantages. In particular, I really want to drive a V12 Vantage S again, particularly actually with the Sport Shift 3 gearbox, the paddle shift, because having experienced this manual again, you know, I know people would want it, and for a sort of weekend car, maybe it's the thing you'd really want, but actually I'm going to use the car a lot, and I think the paddle shift is probably going to be a bit better. It's going to stop me embarrassing myself by stalling the thing. And actually, now I've mentioned it, when Richard and I last spoke, he said that the brief for this now is to make it the ultimate Sunday morning Aston Martin. Because the fact is that the regular car is still a really, really good road car. He wanted this to have something a little bit more. And previously, it didn't work. It just failed in my eyes. This does. I like it. A lot. And with the price point of a regular 4.7 being ever lower, They're a very, very tempting thing. Although, I really do like the faster steering rack of the S. To me, that's a bit of an essential. I think I've spent too much time in Italian cars now. I've gotten used to a quick steering rack. I like it. There's also, to me, something just a little bit more special about a dedicated two-seater. The Vantage for me in that configuration with the bigger boot versus, say, a DBS with two, for me, useless back seats and a smaller boot, it just makes more sense. It's still a slightly frustrating shape, but it's certainly more generous than you'd get in the DB9 or the DBS. And because I do travel all over the place with my camera kit, having that rear storage is useful. If I was going to order one of these, what would I do differently? Well, I'd like to experiment with 18-inch wheels. They will fit over these uprated brakes, but they might look a bit silly. I'm not sure. They would, though, give the car a little more compliance, particularly, I think, at lower speed, where it could do with some of it. I also might dabble with a carbon ceramic brake upgrade, because again, that'll take a little bit of the unsprung mess out and I think do the car's ride a few favours. It also, I think, would be in the spirit of the thing. And I am constantly torn between whether I'd want the V8 or the V12. Yes, I know I said earlier many times this V8 is enough, and I know that the V12 is going to be more powerful, going to be torquier, but also heavier, particularly in the front. I still want it though. Makes a great noise, and the Aston Martin V12 is an iconic thing. It's a very, very special engine, and it makes the car even more special. I would also do a few more bits to the interior, but I know that Richard has that planned already. It just hasn't happened yet, and to be honest, the interior of an Aston Martin is the piece of the car that needs the least help. It's already glorious. Would I buy one? Well, when he's done with it, I am going to ask Richard how much he wants for this, because I do like it that much. Anyway, that's been a little look at a car that is now becoming ever more familiar, but I am glad to see has also improved since I last drove it. I want to say a big thank you to Richard for lending it to me, and as ever, to you for watching. Don't forget to hit the like button, comment down below, and subscribe if you haven't already. I'll see you for the next one. Bye-bye.